All right, so we're flying. We've just taken off, obviously. Now, I have done some more tuning with our duplane. I played around with some of the parameters for the TECS, which is total energy something. But yeah, so that's kind of what we're doing today. We're just kind of flying to check that stuff out. So I'm actually going to flip to fly-by-wire A while I'm here. And I've also set up a new screen just to kind of take advantage of the map view in our duplane. Go ahead and zoom out and track it on the map. And of course, the analog feed is front and center. And we have the webcam, just kind of making the most of the HD recording. So what I want to do, I want to lower my throttle, obviously, to about 37%, which is where I tuned the airplane to fly previously. And you see, even in fly-by-wire A, well, I'm gonna let it fly straight for a minute and kind of settle down and do its thing. You can see it's pretty much holding altitude pretty good, even without altitude hold enabled. That's one of the things that I did configure. Hitting some rough air out here right now, probably a lot of thermal activity from all these plowed fields. But anyway, that's one of the things I configured, was my kind of a artificial horizon, the pitch axis. So now if we go to cruise mode, it should hold altitude much better than it did previously. I see a bunch of birds below me down there flying. I wonder what that was. But anyway, so what I'm going to do now in cruise mode, I want to pull a climb. There's some birds straight below me. So yeah, they're probably out here riding these thermals and things like that. It's not climbing real fast in cruise mode, requesting it to climb. I mean, it's climbing, just not super fast. So that's kind of good. I mean, it's doing its thing. It's not oscillating nearly as bad as it was before. You can see we've released the stick now. We're just letting it kind of hold its altitude. And it's doing a pretty good job of that, between managing the throttle and the pitch axis and all that good stuff. And yeah, you can see we're getting bumped around quite a bit. It's pretty rough. Flying pretty much midday. It's actually 3:39 p.m. Not really midday. Thought it was a little bit earlier than it is. But it's earlier than I usually fly, at least. But yeah, I'm pretty happy with the way it's flying right now with the tuning and stuff like that. You can see these kind of rain clouds, these dark gray clouds. They actually rained on us a little while ago. Wasn't really bad, but we did have a little bit of rain that moved through, and I kind of waited around for that to dry up so the ground wasn't terribly wet. But yeah, you see it's pretty low wind day. It's about 4 miles an hour from the south, but it is pretty turbulent, pretty rough. Like I said, all these bare dirt fields that they've just recently plowed and the sun beating down on them like that, especially with the clouds rolling through. The temperatures have been changing, fluctuating through the day, and the cloud shadows cool spots on the ground and the sun heats them back up. You get a lot of turbulent air midday, which it probably will calm down later, but I kind of didn't want to wait until late. Another thing I did, I can change my OSD. You see this efficiency number on the OSD? There was a lot of discussion about that when myself and some of the other viewers, we noticed that there was an issue with the efficiency readout on the mission planner screen that was obviously not correct. But that value being displayed on the screen right now, that approximately 120 milliamp hours, that's going to be per mile. And that value does seem to make a lot more sense than what we're getting from the mission planner readout. So that's a good thing. That seems to be working properly. And you see just below my vertical speed, I have my altitude and vertical speed, and then the vertical altitude and vertical speed, and then right below that I have a pitch axis. It'll be either up or down arrow and how many degrees. I was just wondering kind of how close my tune was for the board level. Wanted to check that out, and seems pretty well spot on. It's obviously, it's going to be getting rocked around a little bit in the wind here, but it is hovering right around zero, which is what I wanted to see. So that's pretty good. And I did also set up another kind of almost clean OSD feed like that, with just minimal information. But that's the three screens I have set up there. I can switch between those. We'll go ahead and leave that efficiency number up just to, maybe gather more data for the ones that wanted to see it. But yeah, so if I actually switch to fly-by-wire and fly-by-wire A, and I pull it full back stick, and I go full throttle, which I have limited in throttle control modes to 70%, and that's something else I tune. You see, we actually get a really nice rate of climb here. I was kind of happy with that, especially with 70% throttle. We're climbing like 22, 23 feet per second right now, which is not bad. But yeah, we're kind of nearing 900 feet now, so I'm going to go ahead and lower my power and point the nose back home. And I'm going to lose some altitude, just to stay on the safe side. And this is another parameter that I previously tuned. Actually, instead of doing this in fly-by-wire A, I want to go back to cruise. And I want to do a full stick down descent in cruise, just to see how it handles a descent. You can see it kind of overspeeds a little bit, and it doesn't particularly like to descend. I may be able to still tune this a little bit more, but it's definitely flyable, definitely working quite well. So actually what I'm going to do here is I'm going to go back to flybar E, and I've cut the power completely off because we're in fly-by-wire A mode. We can do that now. We can manage our throttle ourselves, and we can lose altitude at a much higher rate, as you can see here. So yeah, this is working out quite good. Go back to cruise. And if I pull a full stick climb in cruise, you can see it does raise the throttle a little bit, pitches up some, not as much as I would like. I would like a little bit more aggressive control over my altitude in cruise mode, but we'll look at that stuff later. So I guess at this point, I'm just going to kind of climb up to, I don't know, 300 or so feet. And we'll try to level off at about 300. Let's see how close we got it there. And if it's not exactly 300, we can fine tune it with the pitch stick. But I just want to get it kind of on a nice number for altitude and let it hold an altitude and see how well it holds it, basically. So yeah, that's flying hands off. Get the radio right there. And I see another bird flying straight ahead. Actually, I'm going to follow him. I'm going to go back to fly-by-wire and see if I can follow that bird and see where he's going. See, now I don't see him anymore. There they are. Yeah. Or maybe not. Yeah, there's one. We would climb up to meet him. Now, where did he go? See, they're pretty good at changing direction pretty quick. I imagine they're probably out here riding some of these thermals that I'm feeling that I'm flying through the airplane. So, yeah, I'm actually not seeing them now. I was just going to kind of see if I could get in a little bit of a formation with them. But, yeah, I'm not seeing any of them anymore. So, maybe not. That's one thing about a fast little wing like this. It tends to outrun the birds when you try to fly with them. But being a little small black wing like it is, I imagine they probably think it's one of them, if I had to guess. So yeah, let's go ahead and lose some of this altitude. And once again, just to stay on the safe side. So I guess we're going to fly out, maybe just fly out east to east. So yeah, I'm going to try to shoot for about 300 or so feet. And what I'll do is I'll get to 300 and fly by wire. And then I'll switch to cruise right at 300. Perfect. So we're kind of bouncing around between about 295 and 300. We must have just hit some more lift. You can see it's climbing while it's pitching down a little bit. So, yeah, I mean, it kind of gives us an opportunity to see how it's going to fly in some of the less than perfect air. in midday rather than the calm late afternoon. My second flight with the airplane, it's actually the fourth flight because I have videos for the first and second flights. I got a quick flight in yesterday when I was doing some more of this tuning stuff. But it wasn't really windy. It was about a 10-mile-an-hour wind yesterday, but it wasn't really rough. But the second flight, when I overflew the fire and so forth, we got to fill it out a little bit in the rough conditions there, but not really terribly rough or anything. But right now is about the most turbulent air that I've flown it in. Like I said, we still have some of that midday sun beating down on the ground and some kind of rain clouds and things like that in the area and nice little wind. So you can see the airplane's getting rocked around a little bit, which is to be expected. But it's doing a pretty good job. You know, it's not flying like silked in locky smooth, obviously. I mean, or locked in silky smooth, rather. Tripping up on my words. But it is doing a fairly good job of holding its heading and course across the ground, as you can see on the map in the bottom corner of the screen there. Obviously, you can see little corrections it's making. It's fighting this crosswind and rough air and some climb and sink and everything else that's going on. But all things considered, it's doing a good job. It's doing about the best it can, really. So, yeah, I guess we're just going to let it fly out here. One thing I wanted to see, you see, we're just over 2 miles now. I wanted to see how long the DragonLink telemetry works using the 25 milliwatt output on the receiver. I'm using the standard DragonLink mini receiver. But right now I'm looking at it. You can't see it on any of my recording screen, but I can see it over on the mission planner. We're holding a 96-97% telemetry link, even out, 2.4 miles now? So yeah, that's working out pretty good. And that does bring up another good point. Topic that I want to talk about. I did receive a 915 megahertz DragonLink V3 system today, and that is courtesy of Mike at DragonLink. So thank you for sending me that. I really appreciate it. We're talking about some of the noise issues from the OSD chips and voltage regulators on some of the Maytag boards that were recently talked about and discussed in the DragonLink thread. And apparently it's more of an issue with the 433 megahertz system than it is with the 915 megahertz system. And he asked me if I wanted to try out the 915 megahertz system, and of course I said yes. I've been a long, long, long time fan of DragonLink since the DragonLink version 1 days. And I actually have them all, still have them all. I have my V1, my V2, my V3 that I'm flying with right now. And we have the 915 megahertz system that we'll be trying out in the future. So, yeah, my telemetry link is starting to drop off a little bit now. It's down to 89%, 88, 87, 86, 84, 83. It's slowly dropping off. I guess we're probably going to lose telemetry soon. We're down to 70% right now. 57%. And we're still getting updates. As you can see, the map is still updating up there. We're at 53% now. I was just kind of curious how well the telemetry link is going to work. But it seems to stabilize. We're back up to about 60% now. 61, 62. It's actually climbing. 63, 64, 65, 68, 70%. It's kind of odd and unexpected. But yeah, we're 3.7 miles out. 77% telemetry link, not bad. Now it may drop off once we turn back home, which we will do in just a bit. I guess we'll maybe push it out to around 4 miles or so. You see, we're getting kind of close to the river. I don't want to overfly, you know, out past the river. Just to make it easier to go and find the airplane if I have to. Something should go wrong. Because like I said, this is just the fourth flight on this airplane. I see some more birds at the top corner of the OSD up there. Or the analog feed, rather. But yeah, there's 4 miles, and we're still sitting on 85% telemetry link. So that's a lot better than I expected, and that's only at 300 feet. So yeah, we're going to start a turn back to home now. And I'm curious how well the telemetry link holds up during that turn. Yeah, it's slowly dropping off. We're down to 60%. 52% now. 52%. It's holding at about 52, but it hasn't updated again. You can see my map is not updating. So yeah, we did actually lose it there for a bit. And there's some birds. See, I could just let it go on the cruise, but I kind of want to let it do its return to home thing. So yeah, let's do that. Let's do a return to launch and let it fly itself home and return to launch. And we have not regained telemetry. It is showing a 0% link now, obviously. It's given up on that. So I'll let it run until it gets the link back, and we'll see what that does. My Dragon Link RSSI is actually dropping right now, too. We're down to, you see the number flashing on the USD. We're down below 20% a couple of times there. It's kind of interesting. 15, wow, I think I saw about 10% there. 8%, 50%, wow. See, yeah, that RSSI is kind of fluctuating quite a bit. That could be some noise on board with the Matek F405 wing like we were talking about, because I do have the receiver mounted right next to it. I had actually intended on leaving the 433 megahertz receiver in this airframe in the wing, but I may actually switch this one out for one of the new 915s and check it out. This might be a pretty good test bed here from what I'm seeing with the performance of the 433. And also, curiously, the RSSI was not this low on the way out. So it may have something to do with the ground wire for my antenna kind of trailing behind like it is, but yeah. We've still never regained that telemetry link. I'm assuming it should... there it goes. Yeah, we just picked the telemetry back up there. We're getting little kind of blips of data anyway. See, it hasn't updated my heading or anything. It's not getting a lot of data through to Mission Planner yet. We're sitting on about a 27% link right now. 26, 23, 21. There it's updating. Heading and the track updated. It did at least. So we're at 2.2 miles and it's starting to update again. So yeah, I'd say the performance is a little bit better on the way out than I expected, and a little bit worse on the way back than I expected for the 433 system in this build. So yeah, I think I might go ahead and put one of the 915 receivers into here and check it out and see how that compares. Pretty good test for it, now that we have a nice baseline. So yeah, I guess so, to keep this video from being terribly long, I guess I'm just going to let it continue to fly home. And once it gets there, I'll go ahead and switch out a return to launch and do either manual or fly-by-wire landing. And cut the video. Yeah, I'm pretty happy with the performance of the RG plane. With the tuning and stuff that I have in it right now. And I know a couple of people asked me for the... a backup of my configuration, basically the list of parameters from Orduplane, and I suggested I wait, ask them to wait until I finish doing a little bit more tuning. Honestly, I'm pretty happy with the way it's flying right now, and everything's working as expected. So I'll go ahead and upload that and probably link it below this video. But keep in mind, anyone familiar with Orduplane, they already know the stuff, but don't just copy my full configuration over and into your board, because that's going to pull over my calibration values for the accelerometers and gyros and things like that, and all of my min and max throws on all my receiver radio channels, rather, and midpoints, which should be set for 1500 anyway. But you'll want to do all that stuff yourself, all your calibration values and all that good stuff, and set up your flight modes and things like that. Basically, just take some of the tuning parameters. Just, I would suggest just doing a compare between my configuration and yours, and then go down the list and just check off the numbers that you know are safe to carry over to your config if you want to fly mine. But, don't just load my full configuration into your board and expect it to work. It probably would cause more headaches than not. And I would hate to be at least partially responsible for that. So with that said, if you take my configuration and use any or all of it in your board, then you take full responsibility for that, obviously. Now I'm curious if my rally point is still set up, which it should be. Or will we... Are you going to pan? Yeah. No, see, it's actually going to circle my home position. Because what I did before this flight, I actually updated it from 4.0.6 to 4.0.7. So I'm guessing it dumped the rally point when I did that. So I don't have a rally point set in Mission Planner. Or in the board, rather. Stored in the board. So I'll have to reset my rally point south of home. And the whole reasoning for that, as you can see on the map here where it circles home, it circles around through the trees and the house and things like that over, you know, kind of to the northeast side of home of where I arm. So if I should ever find myself in a position where I have to let the airplane circle a waypoint or circle the home position like this, and I can't regain control for some reason, and it's just going to fly until the battery goes dead and then it'll land itself out here, then if I move my rally point further south of home out over that open field, you can see right now in the analog feed, there's just a big open flat area with no obstacles out there. So I prefer to set my rally point out there just south of home. So that pattern that it flies when it loiters the rally point will keep it away from the fences and the trees and everything, and it'll greatly increase my odds of recovering the airplane with lesser or no damage. So that's kind of the goal of that whole rally point thing. But what I'm noticing right now, I'm letting it circle home right now, and I haven't touched it. And I noticed my throttle and altitude both are fluctuating much less than they were previously, even in the rough air and turbulent conditions that we're flying in right now, which is the main reason I wanted to tune all those TECS parameters. And I actually have my notes that I saved over here. We'll talk about that while the airplane circles for a minute. But what it basically did, I found my stall speed, which is approximately 20 miles per hour for this one, and I increased that by 20%, which is roughly 24 miles per hour. Then I set my airspeed fly-by-wire minimum parameter to 11, which is rounded up to, and that equals about 26.4 miles per hour by my math. So that gives you a little bit of safety margin for your stall speed, and that's just to prevent stalls. And then I set my AHRS trim Y, which is again adjusting that level position in the pitch axis on the board on the flight controller. I played with that until I got it to fly straight and level in fly-by-wire A at my cruise throttle, which is set for 37% throttle because I don't have an airspeed, so I'm just using a target throttle percentage. And that holds about 40 to 41 miles per hour indicated airspeed, and that indicated airspeed is calculated based on all the other sensors that the flight controller has available. So once we did that, then I pulled a full stick climb in fly-by-wire A, which holds a match pitch angle, which mine is set at the default of 20 degrees max pitch and climb in fly-by-wire A. And then I adjusted my throttle max to maintain that cruise speed around 40-ish miles per hour. And that gave me about 70% throttle max. That's why you see my throttle is limited in fly-by-wire A to 70%. Then from there, I could do a TECS climb max, which is once again at that 70% throttle and full backstick in fly-by-wire A. Then you can kind of check your log and get your rate of climb in that condition. You know, you hold that for a little while, let it stabilize, and you can kind of average that out over the period that you were climbing. And from there, I landed on 8 meters per second for a TECS climb max parameter. Then my TECS sync min, what you do there is you let it fly in fly-by-wire A, you don't touch the pitch or roll axis, pull your throttle all the way back to idle, and let it glide and descend on its own, and let that stabilize, and then you get that rate of descent, which is 1.9 meters per second rate of descent. And you set that for TECS sync min. And then for TECS sync max, which is the last value I changed, what you do there is you climb back up, and you fly straight and level in fly-by-wire A, you pull the throttle back to idle, and then you push the nose fold down and let that stabilize. And you're looking for two things there. You want to make sure you're not going to get your airplane in a condition where it overspeeds. You know, you don't want to get too fast in that situation, which mine was fine at that, you know, at the max speed. It's not overspeeding or anything like that. And then you can check your log there. You know, you dive for a while and let that stabilize, and then you can get kind of an average out of your log there. And I landed on 8.6 meters per second for that value. And once again, that is TECS sync max. Now I would like to take credit for all this and pretend I know what I'm talking about, but I don't. I got help from ATX, I think his username on YouTube is ATX Heli. I could be wrong on that, but I'll put a note on screen if so. But it's Mr. Henry. He's one of the, well, I don't know if, I guess you'd call him a developer for Ordplane. I know he's done some development work for them. He's contributed. And he knows a lot more about this stuff. And he kind of walked me through how to do a manual tune of those parameters. And I took notes and made my little cheat sheet and worked through it. And as you can see, it worked out. Gave me a much better flying airplane. So a big thank you to Henry. And maybe I'll do a video on that someday. I'm not sure. I'll think about it. See. But yeah, so far I like what I see. So yeah, we've been in air for 26 minutes now. Burn 2,500 milliamp hours, and hopefully we got enough efficiency numbers on screen for the people that were asking for those. We can actually turn some of that stuff off. I'll just leave it on. It's not that intrusive. But yeah, we'll take a minute to thank Sonic Model for sending the airplane, to Patreon pledges and YouTube channel members for financial support that I use to buy some of the stuff that I'm flying with. Who else? To DragonLink for supplying the 915 megahertz system that we're going to fly. And yeah, I guess probably forgetting some people, but if so, I'm sorry about that. But I try to thank everyone when I can, but right now my mind is kind of drawing a blank, kind of thinking about a lot of stuff, talking about a lot of stuff. So we're going to go ahead and fly the airplane now. Back to cruise. And I'm going to go back to, actually, did I do a manual or let's do fly-by-wire. So I'm actually going to go ahead and cut the power and start descending, lose some altitude, and set up my landing. I'm going to land east-west this time. Should be okay. It's going to be a crosswind landing, but that's fine. Either way we land, it's going to be a crosswind landing from the south. So, yeah. Pretty happy with the way the airplane's flying and learning some things about RG plane, figuring things out, making progress with that. Real happy with it. So thank you for watching the video. Hopefully it's helpful and enjoyable. I need to get used to how long this airplane glides when my landing approaches. I kind of overshoot my landings. Obviously we have plenty of runway, but I do tend to prefer landing on the runway when I can. Or next to the shot, rather. That's what I meant to say. What I'm going to do now, I'm going to go back and disarm from Mission Planner. Yes, I want to disarm. And I want to check that and see if my little summary screen pops up. I set up another OSD screen on page 4 that I can't access with the switch, but it's set to anytime I disarm the flight controller, it's going to go to the summary screen just for a few more numbers there. Covered 20 miles on that flight. And I guess I have to go back to the OSD to check to see how many milliamp hours we used to do it. 2,686 or 87 milliamp hours to go 20 miles. I like those numbers. I can see some long-range flights happening on this one. Like I said, I only have a 5200 on board. There's already people stuffing 10,000 milliamp hours into these using lithium-ion cells. So expect to see some long flights from this one. But for now, hopefully this has been a good video. Thank you for watching. Keep an eye out for what's coming in the future. And yeah, see you then. Bye.